And we are Facebook Live.
Yes.
Alright, my man. Streaming. Awesome, man. That's awesome. That's awesome. The Lord is good, keeping everybody okay, you know, nobody's super, super sick or anything, so,
yeah,
that's good, praise God. Can you get this door open for me when I come?
Yeah. Yeah, you got 17 online already.
It's a good group out there. I'm amazed.
Yeah.
Amazed. Now, God is awesome. He's doing such good things.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Get my stuff together here. All right, so I got 2 minutes here. Hey, Tom.
What's up?
If I see somebody else come in, I'll just tell you, all right? And I'll leave these, like, right here, okay? So you can get it.
Oh,
I'm gonna go ahead and unmask and everything, okay?
All right.
Yeah, make it live, and I'll be able to hear myself up there in the front, right? Be able to hear myself? Yeah. Alright, it's 1 minute till, so you can just probably start.
Is the mic working?
I haven't turned it on just yet, but
okay.
You probably go ahead and shut the music off, and we'll get started here. Well, good evening, everybody. It is 1 minute till, And I'm going to go ahead and get ready to pray, I think, here pretty soon. I'm so glad that I have somebody physically to preach to. That is so neat. I was telling Tom, I said, if it's you and my wife, that'll be nice. But I'm glad that many of you were able to come tonight, even in the midst of this strange, strange time. I have never experienced anything like this in my ministry, period. 34 years. And there are a lot of worse things that have happened in ministry in Uruguay and in Cuba, much worse. But I'm telling you, I'm grateful that God has given us such peace through all of this, and I praise Him for it. Let's pray together, and we'll go ahead and get started tonight. Father, I thank You so much for Your blessings to us. We don't deserve them. And I am grateful to You for Your way with us. I thank You for Your love. Won't You continue just to be with us tonight, and we'll glorify You as we march forward now in this service time. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, do this for me if you will. Just give me a honk if you can hear me. Okay, good, good. Excellent, excellent, fantastic. I'm going to have Tom go out here. He's going to deal with some of these that are rolling in. He's got some You guys that are just rolling in, he's got some hymns that he'll be giving to you. He's coming out right now, and he's going to take care of you guys while I'm doing the announcements. Okay, thank you so much, everybody. Thank you so much for being compassionate enough to do this drive-in thing for a while. I know it's irritating, but until people are less sick, until people are a little bit more on their feet, I think it's the right thing to do. So continue to keep everyone at church in prayer. The whole community of Seaford has been affected. As I studied the stats today, I was kind of surprised. You can just about name a name of anyone that you know, and they are either likely sick or they know someone who is. So keep praying, recovering well in this neighborhood and in other parts of the city, but there's still a lot of sickness. All our nurses say that it's been manageable, that in the hospital and other places, that it's been manageable. I talked to several nurses, and that gave me sort of an understanding also. Wow. Also, I just want to praise the Lord for our offerings this year for December. It's truly going well. The special Christmas offering for Jesus for added Sunday school space is going well. Please keep doing that and pray about what God would have you to continue to do throughout the month of December. We're closing in on $10,000 already this month, and I'm grateful to you for that. Praise the Lord for that. We will likely have to do drive-in again Sunday, so as we are planning a big celebration on December the 20th, I think that will be the time that we'll have our fun time for Christmas. We'll be very cautious that day. I hope and pray that you'll be cautious with us, really praying about that. Rather than trying to do it in a couple of different weeks, we will have to have drive-in, looks like, again on Sunday, okay? December the 23rd, we'll have the Christmas Eve service, and so you pray about that. That's December the 23rd. Revival in January, December 30th through the 31st, prayer nights, vigil 2021, singing, fellowship, prayer, and sweetheart banquets coming up, of course, in February. I do believe the Lord's getting us through this in a very timely fashion, and I'm grateful for the timing, the way that the Lord does what He does. Do this, my friends. I believe Tommy's about ready back there. We're going to go ahead and we're going to sing our first song, Shout Out for Joy. And so I think he's going to go ahead and get that ready here. And I hope that you got all of those announcements, that it was a blessing to you. And we'll continue forward tonight. Oh, come and see how the name of the Lord is revered. All the earth is alive with a worshipful song. Oh, come to the cross and be free of rebellion and pride. Oh, come and rejoice evermore in all God has done. So great is His power, let His enemies crumble and fall. Forever He reigns, by His might. His eyes are ablaze, keeping watch on the nations of men. All the kings
kings of the earth do his will and all his delight. Shout, shout out for joy, all the earth. Sing, sing of the glory of his name. Say, say unto God how awesome your deeds. Give, give to the Lord his glorious praise. I'm sure you're singing well. I will bless you, O God, when you lovingly test and refine. Though I walk through the fire, I will offer you praise. You will shepherd my soul to a place of abundance and rest. I will come to your house in an offering of thankfulness raise. Oh, come, come and hear all who fear God and call on his name. How I cried to the Lord and he answered my prayer. Had I cherished my sin, would be empty and vain. Bless the Lord for his mercy and faithfulness, crown all our days. Shout, shout out to God. Amen. Sing it out, go in here. Sing, sing of the glory of his name. Say, say unto God how awesome your deeds. Give, give to the Lord his glorious praise. Shout, shout out. Right on to the next one. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Continue worshiping before the Lord. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun. Sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. All thy works rejoice around thee, earth and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around thee, center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, singing birds and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee. Thou art giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever blessed, wellspring of the joy of living, ocean depth of happy rest. Thou our Father, Christ our brother, all who live in love are thine. Teach us how to love each other, lift us to the joy divine. Mortals, join the happy chorus which the morning stars began. Father, love is reigning o'er us, draws us through the Son of Man. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the morning. of strife. Joyful music leads us onward in the triumph song of life.
All right, we're going to go ahead and take up our evening tithes and offerings here. And we're going to do that with the same long pole situation that we did before. I'll probably just take it up myself. Do you have just a little offertory that you're going to do, Tom? Or?
I can find something.
Well, that's okay. I'll tell you what. Why don't you just go to the next song? Why don't you just go to the next song? And while you're doing that beautiful name, then I'll go ahead and take up the offering. Let's pray together, and I'll just take it up myself tonight. Father, I thank you so much for your people. I thank you for the incredible dedication of this congregation, Lord. Hundreds of people online and here on Sunday, thousands and thousands of dollars given, lives changing, people every day, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, on the phone, counseling, getting verses, getting chapters, getting ideas, getting more teaching, getting discipleship, Lord. Honestly, I'm so happy when so many people are engaged like they are right now. I am so encouraged and so blessed by you, because it's you that's leading people to want you. And tonight, Father, tonight's message is all about that. It's all about wanting your house, wanting your tabernacle, wanting your attention, desiring to hear from you, desiring to know your light, your mind, your things. And so tonight, Father, again, your people are yearning for you. And I know, Father, that you are going to give yourself to them as we continue this evening. Won't you continue, Father, to break the bread of life to us in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, you go ahead and sing, and I'll go ahead and take up the offering. Super nice rendition. I love that song to begin with, but that fella knows how to sing. That's fantastic. Behold our God. I believe that was George Beverly Shea. Sounded like it. George Beverly Shea. Let's sing together. Behold our God.
His hands, who has numbered every all creation rises to rejoice. Behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him.
It's a good group of songs.
Yeah. You have given counsel to the Lord. Who can question any of his words? Who can teach the one who knows all things? Who can fathom all his wondrous deeds? Behold our God, seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him.
Amen. Beautiful.
Who has felt the nails upon his hands, bearing all the guilt of sinful man? God eternal, humbled to the grave, Jesus Savior, risen now to reign. Behold our God, seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare.
Come, let us adore
him. He will reign forever. You will reign forever.
Baptist College. As you'll notice, I don't believe Dr. Bruce is here tonight. I didn't see him out here or any of the staff. I know Tim, Wendy, Joe, quite a few of the kids, if not all of the kids, are sick. And of course, you know, with all that's going on, who knows what they've got. So we're just praying that the Lord will give wisdom to them. I don't think any of them have been tested. Most of them are on the other side of it and they're well. But keep the college in prayer. Keep a lot of people in prayer, of course, with the sickness. But also pray for our missionaries. There are things going on all over the world right now, not just in our area. Gratefully, I am so grateful that our area has had a strain of this that's not real bad. But most areas of the world, you know, have had some difficult times. And so continue to be in prayer for all of those things. Let's just go before the Lord. In your car, you go ahead and pray with others if you desire, and I'm just going to give a general prayer, and then we'll get right into the Word of God this evening. Father, I thank you so much for the day. I praise you for the blessing that we've had. I do pray for Brother Moody tonight. I know that he's had a really rough time of this, and yet you, dear Lord God, have kept him from having any respiratory issues to speak of. And I do pray, dear Lord God, we think of Roberta and Oscar and Earl and Ken and Mary and all our favorites and all our people that are here on a regular basis and those that never miss services. We think of Brett and Sue. And Lord, we just go on and on. We gave that big list Sunday night. We could probably just say a name and we probably know that that person is not well. And so we're going to continue, Father, to lift them up. I pray for Sarah, my daughter-in-law. I know she's not well either. And I thank you, Lord, that anyone in our house that was sick is over it. I just pray, dear Lord God, that you'll be with all of those in various places. We see on the map, Lord, that Laurel is about the worst in all of Sussex County. And it's the darkest of blues when it comes to those who are sick. And so I'm just asking, Father, that you'll be with the 19956 area code that they're saying is the worst in the entire county. And so I'm asking, Father, that you'll be with everybody in Laurel and those that are in Seaford that are not far behind as far as blue is concerned in the darkness of the blue. And I'm going to ask, Father, that you'll be with Nanticoke, with the hospitals in general, those who are having to service the people. We do praise you that there aren't too many cases that have needed any kind of care. I'm so grateful for that, dear Lord God, in the grand scheme of things. We do pray also, Father God, for our missionaries. We pray, Father, for souls to be saved in Sussex County, even during this time, whether that be through Facebook, social media, whether that be in person in some way, maybe just a tract given in a store somewhere, someone's life at stake right now for your purposes. Just ask, oh, Father God, that whatever it is that they're going through, whoever's going through whatever they're going through, that you will work to bring people unto yourself and that the world, dear Lord, will come to know Jesus Christ, we pray. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight, my friends, we're going to do an exegesis of Psalm 27. Okay, so you can grab your Bible. You go to Psalm 27 tonight. We're just going to go through. The title to the message is this. For some, it seems they enjoy fear. For some, it seems they enjoy fear. Understand, caution is not the same as fear. We do get that, right? Caution is not the same as fear. It's good to be cautious. It's not so good to be fearful. I've never known more peace in my life than when I'm in long-term Bible study. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Never known more peace than when I'm in long-term Bible study. In other words, when I'm studying the Word of God and the Bible is coming alive and God is just doing His work and the prayer of the Spirit, I'm understanding that He's doing marvelous things. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Honk if you know what that feels like. It's just amazing to be in Bible study with the Lord. Now I want you to take Psalm 27, look right at the beginning. It says this, the Lord, if you could just right there in your car, say it with me, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? There isn't a situation, there isn't a virus, there isn't a person, there isn't an entity, there's no spirit that I can fear, that I need to fear at all, because the Lord, understand this, He is my light. I love John chapter 1 and verse 5, don't you? The darkness, when Jesus Christ came and He presented the light, real light, the darkness, the Word of God says, the darkness comprehended it not. The darkness comprehended it not. In other words, the darkness didn't even know what was going on. The darkness is like, what in the world? What is happening here? Nothing like this has ever happened. This is different. This is Jesus. Wow. And everything in creation had been able to comprehend that Jesus Christ in human flesh had come. I mean, what an incredible concept. So the Lord is my light, but He's also what? The Word says, He is my salvation. He is my salvation. And then it says, who am I going to fear if I've got one salvation? The doctors are not our salvation, not from COVID, not from anything.
I appreciate science. I appreciate the fact that God has given us wisdom and knowledge of things. But the true, honest truth, the biblical truth, is that there's one Savior, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. Less God is less peace. Less Christ is less light. Less of everything He is more problems for those that are around us. I remember when I was in Uruguay, there's a place called Tarariras, which is just a little bit north of where we live. And we went up to Tarariras one time, and there are a bunch of caves in that particular state of the Union of Uruguay. And when you go down into those caves, you get to a certain point, and the director of that cave shuts the lights out. All the lights. And all you can hear is just the whiff of bat wings around you here and there. And I'm going to tell you something. You're talking about fiercely dark. It is amazing how dark it can get in the belly of the earth. But the Lord is my strength. And you know what? He is my light. He is my salvation. He's so bright that the world can't comprehend Him. And this is what the very last part of that verse says. Look at this. Of whom shall I be afraid? Of whom shall I be afraid? Really now, understand. The Lord is the strength of my life. Now if you look at that for just a minute, that phrase, the strength of my life. It simply means this. He is the strength. He is the meat of everything that I have in my life. Okay? He's the portion that I have. Psalm 16 and verse 5 calls Him my portion. Okay? And He's speaking of an inheritance there. There's no question. But at the same time, if you consider an inheritance meat or something that you get, understand back then, land was like money. And so the inheritance or a land piece was like money. It was like meat. It was like something filling my belly. And so understand when the Word of God says here that the Lord is the strength of my life, He's actually saying He's my portion. He is what I get filled up with. What a Christ. What a Lord. Now look with me at verse 2. When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Have you ever heard of a story of a cannibal before? You may have heard of Nate Saints. You may have heard of Elliot and Tia, you know, all the things that went on with those young men way back. And this group of cannibals that killed them, you consider for just a moment what that is in verse 2. It says, when the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh. That's just the grossest thing, isn't it? And yet the Bible says it just in that way, all right, to give us visualization, to give us this understanding that there's enemies out there that hate us so much they would like to devour us, essentially. They would like to destroy us. They'd get rid of First Baptist Church if they could. They'd get rid of every Christian if they possibly could. They're like cannibals, if it were. Look with me, if you will, at verse 3. Though an host should encamp against me, the Word says, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise up against me, in this will I be confident. I can understand the hunt behind all of this. You're looking at verse 3 and it's like a hunt. All right? It's like our enemies are after us. They're hunting us. They're trying to find a way to get in. And I'm going to tell you this right now, just to understand, a lot of the things that we don't understand, we say, how did anybody put this together? They didn't. Satan put all this together. Understand that? It's not any human force. It's not some really intelligent cabal out there that's taking over the world. No, it's not. It's Satan himself who's doing all this. And understand very clearly, my friends, that Satan himself is trying to change the entire face of the world and make it ready for the reception of Antichrist. And here's the interesting thing about all of that. It's falling right into place. Now, I'm going to tell you this. I want you to get this. I want you to understand. I don't want you to get upset with me. I don't want you to get upset with me. Just listen very closely. There's nothing you're going to do about it. Nothing. We start to think, oh, we're going to fight. We're going to somehow take over. We're going to get the world back. No, you're not. No, you're not. God set this up a long time ago. And for thousands of years, it's been prophesied that what we're going through right now is going to happen just like it is. Do you understand that? Okay.
Some of you do. Some of you might not still. But I'm here to tell you, you're not going to do much about it. So what do? The Lord is my light, and He is my salvation. I'm not worried about what men can do to me. They can nibble on my ankles if they want to. They can cannibalize me in any way. They can crucify me so as they desire. But I'm here to tell you that my God and my Savior will protect me. He will guide me. He will help me to be fearless in the face of all that goes on. Why? Though a host should encamp against me, verse 3, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. Why? Why are ye, understand this, from Matthew chapter 5 and verses 14 through 16, why are ye the light of the world? Now we've determined why Jesus is the light of the world. But why does he say in Matthew chapter 5 and verses 14 through 16 that ye are the light of the world? Why is that? One thing, he says, have I desired of the Lord. This is the thing. When people look at the church meeting together as you are tonight, weirdly, with all that's gone on around you in this entire evening, people driving by right now are saying, those crazy people are still out in church. They're still out there doing their thing. How in the world could they continue to do what they're doing in the midst of all of this? What is that? It is a light to the world. Whenever you spread the gospel in the face of conflict, it is a light in the world. Whenever you decide, I'm going to do what God wants me to do, regardless of whether or not people like it is a light unto the world. That's why Matthew chapter 5 and verses 14 through 16 says, this, you're going to be so weird looking that it's going to be a light in the world. Everybody's lamp. Some of you guys have your lights on in your car, and I'm thinking to myself, man, that's a light to the world. My wife put Christmas lights all around her car as well on the inside of the van. I think to myself, the light of the world, Jesus Christ, yes, but Him in you also, Matthew 5. And verses 14 through 16. So one thing have I desired of the Lord. He says, one thing have I desired. Look at this. How many things do we want that we shouldn't have? That's a big question. How many things do you want that you shouldn't have? And here David, the psalmist, gives us an understanding of what every Christian ought to be saying. Look at verse 4. Why don't you read it out loud to me? One thing have I desired of the Lord. That will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple. You say, now those are more than one thing. Well, actually, no. It's just one thing, and that is, I want to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. How many of you would say, you know, right now, sitting out here in the car, I wish I could dwell inside the house of the Lord. I'd like to dwell in the house of the Lord instead of outside the house of the Lord. The many decimals of people that are watching on Facebook, I'm sure you'd love to be in the house of the Lord. You'd like to dwell in the house of the Lord. But you understand that the word dwell means to take up residence. I need to know in my heart, am I truly desirous to take up residence in the house of the Lord? I need no other abode. I need no other luxury, the scripture says. David says, I don't need my own house. I don't need my own kingdom. I don't need my own family. I don't need my own things. All I need, all I want, is to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I need no other abode. I need no other luxury. I need no other comfort. I want to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And what will that yield to him? Well, it says here in this verse, it will yield to him two things. Number one, think about this. To behold the beauty of the Lord. Wow! How do I behold the beauty of the Lord? I dwell with him. I dwell in his house. I think about heaven constantly these days. How many of you are ready to get out of this awful place? How many of you desire to go to heaven and really truly dwell with him? Ultimately, my friends, yes, here on earth, church is about the closest to heaven you can get. But here on earth, that's all there is. In heaven, the real abode of God, the real dwelling place of our Lord, I can't wait to be with the Lord forever. Why? Number one, to behold the beauty of the Lord. And then number two in verse four, and to inquire in his temple. Oh God, oh my Lord, I can't wait to be able to inquire of you and to really know your mind. The beauty of inquiry with God right now is that you can take his word and know everything he wants you to know. Can I tell you that? You can take his word and know everything he wants you to know. You say, now, Pastor, why are you saying it that way? I won't get to know everything? Well, the question is this. Why do you need to? Why do you have to have every answer satisfied if what he's giving you is what he wants to give you? Wouldn't his will be best? Wouldn't it be best for us not to know some things? Isn't it terrible to think that you might know something that would happen and you would alter in a really bad way by knowing those things, some things that would harm you or harm your family? You see, the Lord is good in that he keeps back some of that knowledge, but I can inquire of him. I can inquire at his temple. I can inquire of him in so many different ways. And his word, listen again, his word gives me exactly what I need to know. Exactly. Everything I need to know, he's giving me. For in time of trouble, verse 5, look at this now. For in time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. What is this all about? It's about talking to the Lord. I can hide within the confines of the mind of God, the pavilion of the Lord, and know his heart. I can hear his words. Oh, my friends, if you're not taking the moments every day of Bible study that you need to be able to live, I feel for you. Look at the three things that are found in verse 5. Three things that are found in verse 5. For in the time of trouble, the reason that I want to be a dwelling with God, the reason I want to be in his house, the reason I desire his tabernacle, the reason I desire to be with God's people is, number one, he shall hide me in his pavilion. Number two, in the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. And number three, he shall set me upon a rock. My friends, I get hidden in Christ. I'm allowed to let Christ envelop me. I get so close to him that he gets inside of me and I get inside of him. So those three things in times of trouble are so necessary that, first of all, I'm hidden in his pavilion, in his mind, in his thinking. Number two, in the secret of his tabernacle, that is his worship, his praise. And then number three, he can set me on himself. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 11 says, there is no foundation, no better foundation than that which is laid, which is Christ Jesus. He is the solid rock. I don't have to worry about anything when I'm standing on the solid rock. People can come to me and they can tell me all kinds of nonsense and I'll go, No. I'm sorry. The Word of God says, .. Why? There's solidity in this book. There's rock in this book. I found bedrock in the Word of God. I don't need to wonder if someone is right or wrong. I can look right into the Bible and say, no, that's wrong, and this is right. This is right, and that is wrong. Never forget to put your feet on a solid foundation. And the only true and solid foundation, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 11, is Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ is written right here in this book. John chapter 1 and verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Understand, the Word was in the beginning, the Word was God. It is God. This book, my friends, is Jesus written down. Learn it, consume it, grab a hold of it, love on it. Now look at verse 6. And now shall my head be lifted up above mine enemies, round about me. Basically, this whole thing deals with level eyes, okay? The Word of God is talking about level eyes here, looking over them. In other words, I don't need to look into my enemy's eyes. I let God do that. But I can lift up my head. I can march forward, understanding that my God is the King of the universe. I don't need to worry about anything because my God is the King of the universe. There is no governor, there is no president, there is no antichrist, there is nobody better than him. I don't need to worry about a thing because my God is in control of all things. Now here's the problem. We get so excited, we get so uptight that we start to talk to Satan sometimes. Don't talk to Satan. He's not worth your time, okay? Understand this. The devil is not worth your time. Oftentimes, we think that he is. And we'll start to say, oh, you leave me alone. Oh, I'm going to rebuke you. Oh, I'm going to get after you. No, you're not. God alone can do that. You and I have to let God do that. Jude and verse 7 tells us that even the archangel Michael would not bring a railing accusation against the devil because he feared, he concerned himself. He pulled back. He said, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to let the Lord rebuke you because I have no power. Only the Lord has power over you. Listen, when you do that, you exalt God. When you try to take matters into your own hands, you're putting God down. Understand that when you say to God, God, defend me from the devil. God, you have your way. God, you do your things. Then you're addressing your petition to the right person. You understand what I'm saying? But when you address your petition to a man, when you address your petition to Satan, when you address your petition to anyone else but God himself, you're bringing God down. You're saying, you can't do it, Lord. Don't worry. I'll help you out. I'll go and talk to Satan about it for you. No, you won't. No, you won't. My friends, you'll fail. Understand that when the disciples did this, that the evil spirit jumped upon them and beat them up. And I'm here to tell you that if you try against Satan, to fight against Satan yourself, he'll jump on you and he'll beat you to a bloody pulp. But our God in heaven, thrilled to take over and do what he needs to do. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing unto him. I will talk to him alone, verse 6, towards the end. I will sing praises unto the Lord. So why is praise so vital? Because you're addressing it to the right person. Praise the Lord. Don't defend yourself against the devil. Let God be your only defense. What is that? It's sheer humility when we do that. It is sheer humility when we do that. Address your petition to the right person. Going on to verse 7. Read with me. You got right there your pen knife or whatever, your light above your head or whatever it is. Read right there in the car. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Lord, can you hear me? You know, right now, often as I'm preaching to plate glass and I can't even see you, not even for a little bit, I want to know once in a while, can you hear me, Hong Kong? Okay, good, good, good. And that's how we feel with the Lord sometimes. I'm standing here talking to this plate glass, but I have a whole lot of practice because I talk to nothing in the morning. I look out into the nothingness and I say to God, God, I know you're there. I know you can hear me. You're not necessarily going to honk, but I know you're there. So I'm going to seek your face. Look at verse 7. Seek ye my face, God says. Seek ye my face. When thou sayest, seek ye my face, verse 8. My heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek. Thy face, Lord, will I seek. I may not be able to see you. I may not be able to understand exactly where you're standing and what you're doing at this very moment. But none of that matters. Thy face I seek, O Lord. Thy face I seek. Thy face I'm looking for. That you alone, Lord, are all that I need. Look with me at verse 9. Hide not thy face far from me. Put not thy servant away in anger. Thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake, O God of my salvation. What kind of a prayer is that? What kind of a prayer is that? Don't forsake me, Lord. Please, God, don't. Oh, Lord, I realize you could, but don't forsake me right now. Oh, God, I don't know where you're at, what you're doing, what's going on, oh, Lord. But I know you can hear me because you promised that you would. What is that? It's a prayer of faith. It's a prayer of faith. says, hide not thy face from me. I know you won't. Lord, oh God, you are my salvation. You look, he says, neither forsake me, oh God, of my salvation. Verse 9. And I love this. Look at verse 10. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. Oh, my friends, how many young people, how many people that are orphaned, how many individuals that have lost their way in this world are looking for someone to take them up. The only one, the only person in this entire globe that can take up someone is our God. I have a friend who recently got rejected by their kids. Now, I realize that most of the time it's the other way around. The kids are rejected by the parents. But in this case, this individual is getting a little bit older, and these people just completely left them. Didn't want anything to do with them. Didn't want to talk with them. Wouldn't take their phone calls. Wouldn't relate to them anymore. And that individual has found their way to a good group of believers. They were saved late in life, but they gave themselves over to the Lord, and the Lord has been gracious to them. Understand this. We have a prayer to give when we have no one else in the world but our God to look to. Look at verses 11 through 14, and we're ending today. Teach me thy way, O Lord. Lead me a plain path because of mine enemies. Lord, make it clear the direction I need to go, the things that I need to be doing, the words that I need to be saying. Deliver me not over unto the will of mine enemies. The false witnesses are risen up against me, such as breathe out cruelty. I fainted. God, I would have fallen apart. I would have been destroyed personally had it not been for you. My friends, you have no reason to fear a thing. Not a thing. See, but I'm concerned about this virus. Being concerned and being fearful are two different things. Being wise and being fearful are two different things. There's no reason to fear unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord and the land of the living. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thy heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. That word is extremely important. Wait. Wait. I don't know how many times I've heard that word. My wife says it to me often. Usually when I'm headed right out the door, I'm getting ready to go do something, she'll say, wait, don't you want your breakfast? Wait, don't you think you ought to take this with you? Wait, don't forget that and this. I think half of my life would have been left in the house if it hadn't been for my wife, because she's helped me with that little tiny word, W-A-I-T. How many of us have had God once in a while saying, hey, hey, where are you going? Wait a minute, wait, wait, hey, where are you going? What are you doing? How many times have we had the Lord say to us, wait, wait? Now he says it in this way, in this passage. Wait upon the Lord. I love that little song. Just that one little phrase that goes, wait on the Lord, wait on the Lord, wait. I say wait on the Lord your God, wait. Wait, wait on the Lord. My friends, tonight I tell you this. Sometimes it's good to move forward. Sometimes it's okay to be on the ball and going where you need to go. And sometimes the Lord just says, wait a minute. Wait on me. Look back to me. Realize who I am. Realize what I'm all about. I remember one story years ago, a missionary that talked of their daughter out in the middle of the woods, and she was playing under a tree. And that child was out there not really knowing what was going on, except for that she heard her mother say, honey, sweetheart, come here, come here. And that little kid, kind of confused, looked around, and you know, she'd gotten into the habit of listening to mom and dad as she just got up She left and she started to go into the house. And I can't remember how this was. I think it might have been Mary Baker who gave this story. But she said, because that little girl got up and left, she finally went into the arms of her mother, and her mother picked her up, and they both looked back, and there was a boa constrictor in that tree over the top of that little girl's head. Are there going to be times that God calls to you, and you're not going to know why? There's going to be moments he says, stop for a minute. Hey, be patient. Hey, come now. Do what I tell you to do in the moment I tell you to do it. And my friends, I'm here to tell you that if we won't do what God tells us to do exactly the way he tells us to, we may have our lives cut short. Take Psalm 26 to heart. Take the Word of God to heart. Let God really get inside of you today. And allow this to really get to you. Why don't you take a second, bow your head for just a moment. Right before the Lord, Psalm 27. And just say to the Lord, Lord, I'll wait on you. I understand that any fearful way that I've been, Lord, you can take care of those things. You alone can take care of everything all the time. We know you're in control. God, why don't you take your word and apply it to our hearts. If you're here tonight and you'd say, Pastor, what do I do if I need to be saved? Listen, this virus is not as important as your soul. If you need to talk to somebody, you come right to this door. I'll talk with you. I will deal with you. I'll help you tonight if you need Jesus Christ. Why don't you come? Anyway, any kind of a need, you talk with me. If you feel more comfortable texting me, go ahead and do that. Whatever we need to do to progress with the work of the Lord tonight, we will. Are you needing some kind of help? Let me know right now. Let me know. Father, I thank you for this crowd. Thank you for the blessing of those that were online as well. We glorify you, for you've done marvels this week. We are overwhelmed by it and thankful for it. Keep moving, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a pleasant evening, everybody. We love you. We hope to see you Sunday, as the Lord wills.